Can the clerk call up the next witness, please?
Tom Kline.
Good afternoon, Mr. Kline. Have a seat. Pull the mic up to you. You need to state your name for the record and begin your testimony.
I will do so. Councilman Jones, councilmen and councilwomen, thank you for hearing me. I represent Latifa Rashid. I also represent the little girl who was abducted. More than coincidentally, I happen to be a licensed teacher in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania.
Wow.
I taught sixth grade for 6 years, and I was in a classroom, so I think I know a little bit more than maybe your average lawyer.
You have several teachers on this panel.
No more noble profession, in my view, maybe than other than a lawyer.
we get a lot of debate on that one.
I think you would get a lot of debate. Here's why I'm here, and I'll try to be brief. In fact, I will be brief. It was an event of horror and a crime that was, as I've described it, there's been no crime more heinous in our city, and in a city that's shell-shocked of crime. And it was a worse nightmare for a mom and just a wonderful family. I am here to say a few things with a different focus. First of all, I commend City Council for doing what they're doing, looking at this issue carefully. And I equally believe that it is extremely important for the school district to look at the issues that are in front of them. There were major breaches the day of this incident. And I, for one, am a person who believes that we can learn from the past and something good can come out of something bad. The fact of the matter is that we had an incident where an intruder walked into a school. There was no ID in the sign-in. The intruder walked into a classroom unimpeded. A substitute teacher let an intruder take a child supposedly to breakfast, a child who had just been delivered to the school. The intruder walks out of the school with the child unimpeded, and the school doesn't know about it until dismissal time. Now, my word, what happened here is unimaginable and unthinkable. Now, policies and procedures that were correct and ones that could and should have prevented this were not in place. But the very policies and procedures that are and were in place were violated. So it means a number of things to all of us who are here and who care about these issues a lot. And I've been now a resident of this city. I happen to be someone who lives in this city, not only works in this city, but lives in this city. And I'm proud of it, and I'm proud of this city. But we need a number of things. It is clear to me that there are a number of good recommendations on the table, and they should be taken seriously, and they should have your input, councilmen and women, and they should be scrutinized carefully. And no stone should be left unturned. But at a core of this, of what happened in that school that day, January 14th of 2013, to this little girl. And I've said before publicly, and it can't be repeated enough, the crime and the injury to the little girl I represent was horrible, unthinkable. If I leave it with just those words and with that passion, hopefully you can get a sense of how important this dismissal policy really is. And what we need in this city is a uniform policy and procedure that is scrutinized at the highest level of government. We need a published policy that everyone understands, not just those who have access to the internet, but print it out for people who don't have it. A lot of parents don't have the internet, and make sure it's known far and wide. And We need things like written guardian approval. And as I sat here today, I thought that good minds, and I don't pretend to know everything here, but we can have matching systems. It doesn't take a lot of imagination to know that a little five-year-old who's going to be picked up by someone, if they have a photocopy of an ID, you can match it with the photocopy of an ID of the person who comes. That doesn't take either technology or a lot of ingenuity, frankly. And most important, in the context of a little girl who they didn't even know was missing all day, and a substitute teacher who had no clue as to what to do. We have to make sure that every individual who goes into a school, substitute teachers, student teachers, personnel, cafeteria workers, that everybody understands the need to be, as I wrote down here, aware and vigilant. Because absent awareness and vigilance, and absent a program of training of awareness and vigilance, there will be no remedial measure that is either satisfactory or, frankly, one that will actually work. This case proves it. It's proven, and we can only learn from this case in the past. We know all of the things that went wrong, and every one of them can be corrected if we have a policy in place. The school district has publicly accepted responsibility. That's a good first step. But I, for one, as a citizen of the city, am concerned about our little ones going forward, as you are. Thank you for your good and hard work, and most important, thank you for hearing me. I'm the one who's speaking for the family now. They need support, love, and care, and they've had every bit of this from a wonderful community who has supported a little girl in need. Thank you.
I guess, you know, for every bad thing, something good can come of it. And what I hope comes of this is good public policy that is replicated here at our daycare centers, at our senior centers, because the same kind of problem can happen at a different end of the aging spectrum. So it's a teaching moment, as my colleagues often like to talk about, and all of us are paying keen attention to this issue. And again, this is the first step in a dialogue. They submitted this, policies, we're gonna review them, we're gonna get back to them. Hopefully they heard some of the suggestions you and others are making, and that it gets synthesized and made aware to everyone, universally understood. So if you're a substitute teacher or the principal, if you're the janitor or the person in the lunchroom, everybody understands these are the policies and procedures for dismissal of, if we were, I read somewhere, it was one quote, if we were checking out bank accounts or money or jewelry, we would have a policy in place on that. Those things are mere trinkets compared to our young people. No you doubt. Can replace a diamond, I mean, but you can't replace those tender souls that we have. So we take this seriously. Councilwoman Blackwell has been chair of the Education Committee, so this is nothing new for her. Councilwoman Blonda Wells Brown is one of our stronger children's advocates and former teacher. Councilman O'Neill is not new to this system and has been a part of many struggles dealing with our young people and our education system. So we, as chair of public safety, I didn't feel real safe that day when she was abducted. And so we're gonna learn from it. I mean, we can't go back in time and change it, but we can doggone sure change how we go forward. And we intend to do that. We really appreciate you coming out today and sharing these proceedings with us. And all the best to the family, and our prayers and thoughts are always with them.
It's very much appreciated. Mm-hmm. Thank you for hearing us. We thought it was important that you know that there's a family here, and they know that there is a lot of public concern. I especially commend Councilwoman Blackwell for the long service on this issue. Wow, it's amazing. Going back to her late husband. It's wonderful.
Don't mention her age.
She's one of the few people in this room who's older than me. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. All right. Okay, can we call the next witness, please?